A warm welcome to all dignitaries. The world is full of diamonds and the gems, and we are having some of them here today in this workshop. An introduction to women position in philosophy organizes the Department of Philosophy, Vasanta College, and the Champion Committee of the Department of Philosophy, Delhi University. We are gathered here to discuss many things about this scenario. We have a galaxy of scholar to deal with topic. Now I request beloved our principal, Professor Alka Singh, for the welcome address.
Thank you, Dr. Archana Tiwari. Yes. Good morning to one and all who are present on this very important platform organized by the Department of Philosophy, University of Delhi, along with the Department of Philosophy, Vasanta College for Women, BHU Rajghat. An introduction to women's position in philosophy is a very vital topic which they have selected for the many webinars that I have been attending. It appears to me something which is very important, vital, out of the box, and something we need to ponder and think about. So primarily, I would begin with expressing my happiness in having selected this topic by both the University of Delhi and that of Rajghat to help us think and work out as to what is really lacking when we look at the women in philosophy. Philosophy has been a male-dominated domain, and all philosophical discourse, as I look at the history of the discipline, explains the gender bias that is so very evident in looking at the philosophers, beginning right from Aristotle to Plato. If you look at the Western ancient philosophical discourse, we literally find that women are more or less just not seen there. We do have, I would not say that there were no women philosophers, but they were somewhere finding themselves, or their voices were finding themselves on the margins. They had to say or contribute some very important aspects, but they were on the margins. If I look at Western philosophy and I look at them in ancient times, if I look at Arete or Hypatia, all of them, they were there, but very few of us, and especially in our higher education, we somehow find that the mention is somewhere missing. In contrast, in the Indian philosophy, as we look at it, we do find women representation being talked about in philosophy on this concept, whether I look at Gargi, Maitri, Ubhaya, Akka, Mahadevi, any one of them. But at least their presence is felt in the late 20th and 21st century, where we have all been talking about. In medieval and modern times, we find a very meager representation, but the existence is there. When we look at the work of Suzanne or Hannah or Simone de Beauvoir, we find that they are coming to the forefront. And today, as I look at it, with all the philosophers coming on the forefront, we have a lot of women representing, and important women. Needless to say, Mary Wollstonecraft in the medieval times was one very important woman writer of its time. But somewhere, we down the line feel that it is a malest and a whitest field, as Saul has mentioned, when we look at philosophy. So I feel that this is very important And these stalwarts, the speakers on this platform, will give a very vital dimension to the topic. And I welcome all my guests on behalf of the Vasanta College family and the University of Delhi for this very important forum. Primarily, I would like to express my gratitude to Professor Chandrakala Tripathi, who is the keynote speaker today, and she so very happily, willingly supports us all, for we are all somewhere students of Professor Padia, and we take this privilege of asking her to be with us in all our endeavor. Madam, I'm so very grateful. You have been continuously supporting us during this lockdown period, and I'm so happy that you have associated yourself with the Department of Philosophy as well. I welcome you on behalf of the college. I also feel very privileged to welcome Professor Bala Ganpati Devarakonda, Head Department of Philosophy, University of Delhi. So I'm very sorry if there has been a mispronunciation on my part of the name, but I'm extremely happy to have you on this platform with us, and I'm sure that all the participants are going to benefit out of this conference or workshop that we have organized. I would be failing in my duties if I do not mention the energy, and would like to particularly welcome, of course, the host herself, but a new name to me, Dr. Ritu Jaiswal from the Philosophy Department, University of Delhi, who has been by the side of Dr. Archana Tripathi from Vasanta College right from conception to its execution today. Dr. Ritu Jaiswal, I'm very happy and I welcome you to this platform where we have gathered. I'm also happy that Shri S.N. Dubey, sir, our manager of the college, a gentleman with versatile energy, knowledge, and compassion. And I would not say I'm grateful to him, because he is with us. He is with the family and a part of the family. And it is his compassion that endears him to all my colleagues in Vasanta College, and they take it as their prerogative to directly approach him to be a part of the platform. And so very happily, he accepts it. So I'm so happy that you give so much time to the college and the efforts of the college. Along with this, all my colleagues from various parts of the country, our parent university, Banaras Hindu University, my own college, student participants, I consider it my privilege to welcome you all on behalf of the Department of Philosophy from University of Delhi and that of Vasanta College for Women. Thank you for being with us. I hope we have a week's long workshop which will enrich us all. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Professor S.N. Dubey, manager, Vasanta College for Women, is a trustee at the Krishnamurti Foundation India and the director of the Rajghat Education Center, Krishnamurti Foundation India, since 2011. He has been an officer of the Indian Administrative Service from 1971, and as a divisional commissioner, he has also been the vice chancellor of Bhagalpur University in Bihar. He was director general of Administrative Training Institute in Ranchi and was posted in Government of India, New Delhi, for 10 years on various posts. After retirement, he worked as a state election commissioner for 18 months and they joined Krishnamurti Foundation India. I welcome, sir. I would like to request for an inaugural remark.
Thank you, Ratna ji, for such kind words. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir, audible.
Dear Professor Chandkala Pandya, ex-Vice Chancellor, MSG University, Bikaner, Professor Devarkonda, Head Department of Philosophy, University of Delhi, Professor Alka Singh, Principal, Vasanta College, Dr. Achana Tripathi from Vasanta College, and Dr. Ritu Jaiswal from Delhi University, who are the convener and co-convener of this workshop. And all my colleagues from Vasanta College, including Dr. Rajesh Chaurasia, and all the participants. I'm very happy to be a part of this workshop organized by the Department of Philosophy on such a contemporary and important theme. Let me tell you, I have very little formal exposure to philosophy as a discipline, but I'm certainly interested in philosophy as a medium of exploration of life and profound problems that we face in our life. Although men have generally dominated philosophical discourse, women have been philosophers throughout the human history. As Alka ji pointed out, in ancient philosophy in India, women made many vital contributions. In the oldest text of Upanishads, which are perhaps around 700 BC, the female philosophers Gargi and Maitreyi are part of the philosophical dialogue with the sage Yagvalyak. Ubhay Bharati around 800 AD and Akka Mahadevi during the 12th century are other known female thinkers in the Indian philosophical tradition. Even in the Islamic world, Rabia Basra, during the 7th century, had talked about profound things of life. And Western world, of course, we are quite familiar with. While academic philosophy was typically the domain of male philosophers, such as Plato and Aristotle, female philosophers such as Hipparchia of Maronia and Arete of Cyrene and Aspasia of Miletus were active during the period. I was going through a report published in 1990, which indicated that very few women ended up in philosophy, and that the philosophy is one of the least gender proportionate fields in the humanities. And I was surprised to note that women make up as little as 17% of philosophy faculties in some studies. Another report of 2014 described that philosophy, discipline's own long history of misogyny and sexual harassment of women students and professors. In 2014, it was stated that women are leaving philosophy after being harassed, assaulted, or retaliated against. In the early 90s, a government report claimed that there is a gender imbalance and gender bias in the academic field of philosophy. And it further said that out of recent citations in 4 prestigious philosophical journals, female authors comprise just 3.6% of the total. Many people have raised concerns about the underrepresentation of women philosophers, while other areas of the humanities are at or near gender parity. Philosophy is actually more overwhelmingly male and even male dominated than even mathematics. I think this calls for serious concern. Is it because an intellectual commitment and a political movement that seeks justice for women and the end of sexism in all forms, motivated by the quest for social justice? Feminist inquiry provides a wide range of perspectives on social, cultural, economic, and political phenomena. Yet, despite many overall shared commitments, there are numerous differences among feminist philosophers regarding philosophical orientation and ontological commitments, such as the category of women and what kind of political and moral remedies should be sought. if we examine this historically, we see that contemporary feminist philosophy scholarship emerged in 70s as more women began careers in higher education, including philosophy. As they did so, they also began taking up matters, their own experience for philosophical scrutiny. Most of the philosophers writing in the first decade of the emergence of feminist philosophy brought their particular training and expertise to bear on analyzing issues raised by the women liberation movement of the 60s and 70s, such as abortion, affirmative action, equal opportunity, the institution of marriage, sexuality, and love. Feminist philosophical scholarship begins with attention to women, to their roles and locations. What are women doing? What social, political locations are they part of, are excluded from? How do their activities compare to those of men? Are the activities or exclusions of some groups of women different from those of other groups, and why? What do the various roles and locations of women allow or preclude? How have their roles been valued or devalued? How do the complexities of a women's situation, including her class, race, ability, and sexuality, impact her locations? There has been no shortage of speculation about why there are not many women philosophers. Perhaps women are turned off by philosophy's confrontational style. Perhaps women are more inclined towards careers with practical applications. But the most plausible hypothesis is perhaps that various forms of explicit and implicit bias operate in philosophy, as they do within and beyond other academic disciplines. Unfortunately, though, this expression refines our questions rather than answering it. Why should bias be any greater in philosophy than any other humanistic disciplines? Is sexual harassment usually common only within philosophy? Might our implicit assumptions about what a philosopher should look like and sound like be especially hard to reconcile with our implicit assumptions about women? Overall, perhaps, female students find the course less enjoyable and the material less interesting and relevant in their lives than male students. Contrary to some speculation in the field, female students did not perceive classroom discussions as overly aggressive, and they were no more likely to say that students in the class failed to reach each other with respect. I'm sure this workshop in the course of next 1 week, we'll look into all these issues and deliberate on it. I want to wish the organizers and participants to have a great learning experience, and I'm especially thankful to Arjuna Ji for making me a part of this workshop, and thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, such a nice kind words. And next, sir, philosophy has all along been regarded as such a search for truth and knowledge concerning the universe, human existence, perception, and behavior as a pursuit by means, by reflection, reasoning, and arguments. Western philosophy is said to have begun from wonder or from our feeling curious in respect of what is so far unknown. The two approach require as to be watchful in respect of what is there, and at the same time to be as much sometimes to the suffering of others as to our own. I would like to request Dr. Ritu Jaiswal present the theme of workshop. Ritu, she is an assistant professor and convener of the Champion Committee, the Department of Philosophy, Delhi University, and co-convener of this workshop. I request Dr. Ritu to present the theme of workshop. Dr. Ritu.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Before I start to say anything, I would like to thank all of you for coming to this platform and supporting us in order to reflect over the problem of problems we face, like, you know, women face in the field of academia. And this workshop is primarily meant for raising the issues which are you know, dealing with the philosophical understanding of how we look at the concept of self and how we look at the concept of society and how we look at the concept of individuality. So, you know, the way right now Professor Dubey has elaborated that the situation according to the statistical data is quite bad, but I would like to defend my case that at least in our department this is not the case. So women students take very actively participate, and in our department there are so many girls who are actually doing research in this area also, and I think that Professor Bala, our head of department, will second me. So I would like to present the concept note of this workshop, which is like, you know, obviously it wants to show that how society, you know, the society in which we are living is very misogynistic, and obviously it has treated women as the subordinated being. But at the same time, you will have to we will have to find out the reason behind that. And there have been so many women philosophers and also male philosophers who have tried to come out with their own thoughts and understanding that what has been the reason behind such kind of this hierarchical arrangement in the society. And we see that sometimes they base it on the anatomical understanding, sometimes they base it on the biological differences, sometimes they base it on the social construction. So there are so many speculations regarding the differences which exist at the social level between genders. And also, you know, this gender discrimination or the gender hierarchy which we are referring to is not only limited to women, even though, you know, this workshop is quite limited to women's position in philosophy. I would be very happy if someone is also dealing with other genders problems too. However, you know, if we look at the development of the feminist movement, generally we see that in the Western world it has initiated with the three waves of feminism. And there, you know, from the starting of first wave of feminism, people have fighting for the rights and liberties and other protections of women and participation of women in various fields like academics too, and politics too. But, you know, they have been failing due to some reasons. However, you know, during the second wave of feminism, this became a huge issue, and thinkers like Simone de Beauvoir, J.S. Mill, and Mary Wollstonecraft, and Cady Stanton, Betty Friedan, all of them were fighting for the, you know, for understanding that what is the reason behind such kind of discrimination and why women have not been able to participate hugely in the public sphere and political sphere at the social level as well. So we'll have to see that what is that thing which is stopping women from participating in all the spheres of academia as well as other social and educational fields and political fields. So this workshop is going to deal with such kind of questions. And also, on the other hand, this is not limited to the Western aspects of it, but if we look at the development of feminist development, which is not which has not been nomenclatured as a feminist movement, but it has been nomenclatured as a fight for women's right, which we can see in the form of during the colonial period, Jyotiba Phule and Savitri Bai Phule, and also like Sarojini Naidu and Ram Mohan Roy, all of them, you know, even Gandhiji, they were all of them were concerned about the rights of women, because they knew that women are the ultimate foundation of the society. So we cannot ignore their preferences, we cannot ignore their well-being. And in Indian text and classical philosophy, we can see that with during the Vedic period, there have been so many women philosophers, like, you know, or women intellectuals who were participating at greater level, and some of them were Maitreyi, Gargi, Lopamudra, Ghosha. But we'll have to think about it, like, you know, whether these kind of discussions which we are initiating and we are trying to represent that, okay, these are some of the philosophers who have talked about the problems of women and how women have been treated as a subordinated being in the Greek philosophy and other philosophies as well. You know, can this discussion be limited to the views of these thinkers only? Do we need to focus more on the everyday life's challenges and how philosophy is going to help us out in there? Because, you know, generally it is understood that philosophy is something which is really based on the speculative part, because we, you know, try to think about, you know, what the society should be doing and how the society should be. So, with these questions, I would like to say that it is the primary concern, it should be the primary concern of the philosophy that we should take into consideration all these problems which has been largely taken up by sociology, history and literature, but not that well by philosophy department. So in order to enrich the philosophical discussion over all these issues, we have tried to organize this workshop, and we think and we hope that this workshop will come out with success, with so many lectures by reputed speakers, and we will also try to think about the contribution of women in their academia and literature, art, culture, history, classical texts, everywhere. So we'll have to see and try to present not only the philosophical approach, but also the approach from literature's perspective or history's perspective, that how women could be could raise their position by their own participation and also by the philosophical discussion. So that is it from my side. And I hope the concept note has given you some kind of idea that what we are going to deal with in this, in this workshop. So with these words, now, you know, I would like to thank this organizing committee. And now I would like to invite Professor Balagarpati Devarakonda, as the president, to give the presidential address. And before I do that, I would like to introduce sir, because, you know, he is the head of the department, which is like, you know, my own department, Department of Philosophy. And, I would like to introduce us that his research interest areas are Indian philosophy, philosophy of religion, and social and political philosophy. He is presently working on a project titled Yoga Consciousness in Mahabharata, the Ethical Value for Societal or Political Well-being, and has completed research projects, A Study of Doctrinal Differences of the Early Buddhist Sects of Andhra from 2015 to 2018, and Culture Through the Labyrinth of Globalization, A Study of Popular Imaginations and Alternative Narratives of Digital and Non-Digital Telugu Literature, which was completed between 2017 and 2019. He is serving as the Regional Coordinator of India Council for Research in Values and Philosophy for Washington, D.C., and Chief Advisor, Center for Ethics and Value, Ramanujan College, New Delhi. He has been associated with various journals and has published at various platforms. And he is presently a member of Research Project Committee of ICPR, New Delhi, and a member of the committee constituted by UGC for drafting learning outcome-based curriculum framework, which is, you know, very important for all of us to learn for philosophy. He is a Chancellor's nominee for the Board of Management of Mohan Lal Sukhadia University, Udaipur, for the year 2018 and 19. He is also the Chairman of the Government Body of Maitreyi College, New Delhi, for the year 2018 and 19. So I would like to add one more line, which is not mentioned in his bio note, is that, you know, he is not only the head of the department, but he is also a guardian. And he has this special quality of not saying no to any of his colleagues whenever we ask for any help. So with these words, I would like to invite Professor Bala to say a few words. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ritu, for this wonderful introduction. In fact, when all of you are coming with only academic assignments, why should I say no? Because head of the department is only a facilitator, right? So, Dr. Alka Singhji, Principal of Vasanta College for Women, Rajghat, and Sri S.N. Dubeji, who has given a wonderful statistical data regarding women's position in philosophy. I don't know from which place it is, but that's the wonderful data that he has given us, the manager of Vasudha College for Women. And Professor Chandrakala Padiyaji, who is going to deliver keynote address today. In fact, when ma'am is going to speak, I should not speak much. I understand my limitations because I am not an expert in this particular area. But being by virtue of being head of the Department of Philosophy at Delhi University, I am here. I understand my limitations. So I am really happy to be here, ma'am. I am really looking forward to hear you. And the convener and co-convener, Dr. Rachna Tripathi and Dr. Ritu Jaiswal. In fact, Dr. Rachna ji, she has been in constant touch with me, and she was giving me all the information along with Dr. Ritu and trying to persuade me to join. And I'm so happy that this collaboration between University of Delhi Department of Philosophy and the Department of Philosophy of Vasudha College for Women is working out and coming out in this wonderful format of a 7-day workshop on an introduction to women's position in philosophy. Basically, such kind of deliberations are required. You know? The position of women in philosophy, or position of women in science even, any discipline for that matter, is to be deliberated. And this such kind of deliberations are very much required. And I'm so happy that Vasudha College has come forward requesting Delhi University to be a part of this program. And I'm sure this kind of a discourse will not end anywhere. It would continue for a long time. And this is going to be a very good beginning, because we are doing it in Varanasi, in association with Varanasi. So I'm sure it would go a long way instigating other people as well from other disciplines, as well as within philosophy from other perspectives as well, to come forward and deliberate on this particular theme. But when we are talking about women's position in philosophy, of course, we have already clarified in the title itself, saying that it is only an introduction. Okay, so that guards us. But otherwise, what is it that we are looking at? We are looking at women's position in philosophy. How do we do that? Are we what kind of perspective with which we are going to reach that? No, that is very important for us to understand, because as we have listened to Dr. Alka ji, who has presented the missing picture of women in academia, and also as presented with statistical evidences by Dubey ji, saying that there is a kind of disparity, there is a kind of biasedness with regard to women's position in academia, right? This is what he has presented. In fact, I'm curious to know, sir, I would like to read this document as well, whether, to understand whether the document itself has any biasness. Okay, so I would be really interested to read this document. I'm curious, and I would definitely do that. But as my colleague Ritu has stated, is it that the situation is same everywhere? Are there any changes that we see? At least when we are looking at it from the present contemporary perspective, we need not have a look at the total picture to be a completely gloomy kind of one. Are there any developments that have come? Are there any positive things that have come up? So if we can have a look at such kind of positive things, they are the ones which would help us to move further and try to improve the situation if the situation is bad. Now, in that particular context, I would say, as pointed out by my colleague Ritu, half of our faculty members are women, right? And if you look at the student strength, we have a huge student strength. For example, we give admission to 400 students for MA first year batch. Okay, so if we take it that way, the boys, the strength of men would be only 10 to 20% among the students. So that is the kind of response that we have. That is the kind of strength of women that the department has. So I just want to place this on record along with Dr. Ritu, so that you would understand that whatever gloomy picture that we get of the contemporary scenario is not completely true. And also, once the new faculty members have joined, when all of us have joined, in fact, Ritu does research on feminism in philosophy, feminism in films as well. No? So the diversity, the kind of positiveness, and also the kind of diversity of knowledge acquisition and assertion of women's position has so much, it has so much enriched the discourse itself, which we have to really have a look at. So I'm not trying to say that this positive picture is everywhere, but I am also not, I am also stopping you from making a kind of generalization regarding the gloomy picture as well. So both of them have to be like balanced. So if that is the case, what is it that we are supposed to do in this workshop that we have? Before we make any kind of generalization, what is all the time required is a kind of stock taking, okay? And in fact, with regard to the stock taking, again, I would go back to Dubeji, S.N. Dubeji, who has presented us this wonderful report. But we should also look at the positivities and positive developments that the recent past has witnessed, which is also very much required. And also, when we raise this question of women's position in philosophy, are we talking about women philosophers? Okay, which means looking at the past and trying to see how many women have authored philosophical texts. Is that what we are trying to do? Or are we trying to look at the conception of philosophy that we have, whether it has sufficient representation of femininity or womenhood in that? Okay, these two are two different questions altogether, and these two are equally important. I'm not saying that only one is important. Okay, of course, the representation of the women in the among the philosophers is required, and even here there is a kind of division that we have to keep in our mind, because when you say the Gargi and Maitreyi, you're talking about them in terms of philosophers who exist some time back, but when you actually talk from the contemporary perspective, you would be talking about academia largely, okay? And how academia looks at something to be philosophy, and in that particular domain that you have looked at, whether women's participation is there, right? So this is largely, like I'm saying, unless we have these conceptual clarities, we cannot make any statement. Forget about generalization. We cannot even make a statement. Forget about generalization. Okay. So that is how stock taking is very important. Looking back and trying to, because we don't have to be judgmental. We don't have to be general. We don't have to make any hasty generalization. But what is required on our part is proper kind of stock taking and trying to assess objectively the positions that I was referring to. I mentioned two things. One is that the women philosophers did exist in the past, and who are they? And this, as I said, limited, because I'm so happy that one of the previous speakers has mentioned Akka Mahadevi, a wonderful philosopher who, if you look at it from contemporary perspective, you have to say that she is a rebel feminist. But actually, she never bothered about such kind of things. But she wanted to assert the reality of her own self. Okay, whether you would really say whether her own self in the sense of femininity, that also would be largely like a questionable kind of one. She as an individual self is trying to assert, and then come out with her own philosophical thoughts, which is a wonderful one from Karnataka. But what I'm trying to say is, what is it that we are looking at? Are we trying to look at the female philosophers in the past? And if that is the case, whomever you take now the names, I would argue saying that these are only exceptions, and on the basis of exceptions, you can never make a generalization. If you give me the names of Gargi and Maitreyi, I would argue saying that these are exceptions, and on the basis of exceptions, if you try to make any generalization, I would say be careful. Okay. So the problem is our conception of philosophy itself he is largely limited by the framework of academia, and that is what has stopped us from looking outside what is given to us in terms of academic philosophy. That narrows our perspective, and this is to be widened. This is to be like enlarged. No, only then you would be able to have a proper picture of that. Having said that, my concern is not that. Actually, my concern is the second aspect that I explicated just a few minutes before. The second is whether when philosophers were trying to philosophize, did they give sufficient space for femininity as well? Okay, have they given sufficient space for the female as well? No, that was my concern. That basically, that's on this particular aspect, I would speak for 5 to 10 minutes, and then I'll withdraw because I was told that I am given only 20 minutes of time. So I'll try to do justice to that, because I also have a separate lecture scheduled on 30th. So I would take sufficient time on that day. So when I say I would like to look at the kind of position that the philosophizing enterprise of philosophizing itself, whether it has given sufficient space for women, what I mean to say is, for example, you look at various philosophical systems and try to look at their metaphysics and see when they were conceiving their metaphysics, when they were conceiving their reality, whether they have given, whether they try to be objective in the sense that going beyond the genderedness, or whether they were largely gendered in their conception of their reality. This is very important. Reality, what it is, how is it conceived, how is it conceptualized? It seems to be most of the times that they were trying to conceptualize reality in terms of the absolute universal kind of one. But these absolute universals, friends, are always empty. The absolute universals are always empty. When they say, when they use the word man and then say we are referring to human beings, all of them. So such kind of absolute universals are absolutely empty, and they don't give space to men themselves, forget about women, right? So that is the major problem that we find with these absolute universals, which we have to be very careful with. And what kind of attributes do you provide to this reality that you are conceptualizing is another important question. And we understand that you have a look at each one of these philosophers starting from ancient Greek times and try to see how the reality is conceptualized by each one of them. Then you would clearly find out that there is, when they're talking about their metaphysics, when their conception of metaphysics is contributed, I mean articulated, there is a kind of a slight biasness that comes up glaringly. So that is very important to be noted. And the second one is epistemology. Epistemology has become a very important discourse in the recent past. Initially, metaphysics has asserted itself, and then there was a shift towards epistemology, because even if you're talking about metaphysics, it is largely through epistemology that you're trying to reach out to that. So that is how, in the recent past, there is an assertion of epistemology, and feminist epistemology has diversified and has provided rich resources. Resources are not anywhere. You go back into the history and start looking at any text, that itself will become a rich resource for you to look through your own glasses of genderedness or biasness. So that is where the knowing, the very process of knowing in epistemology, seems to be not completely fair, in the sense that when you say knowing, I am trying to know, you seem to be, obviously we come across subject and object whenever we talk about knowing or knowledge, and who is subject and who is object is always a complicated issue, and it is always from the perspective of one gender that one gender is conceptualized to be the subject, and the other is always understood to be an object. So this distinction is very well available. See, I would say if you like to read Thomas Hobbes, you read. If you like to read Kant, you read. But read through these lens and you would clearly find whether this particular philosopher is gendered or biased or not. Okay? So what I mean to say is, It's not that the feminist philosophy has to look for the resources, or you have to look for the position of women in a separate way, no, in the concrete individual way. But instead, you pick up your favorite philosopher and open and start reading. Then new areas would emerge and open up for you, and which would really give you wonderful insights as to how this particular philosopher is trying to conceptualize the philosophy, conceptualize the reality, and the ways of understanding the reality, how he has or she has articulated. So these are two important things. And the third important one for me is ontology, the being and the relational being, how the being is related to the other. So even if you look at this relational being, it is always a complicated one in philosophy, in the sense that the gender, other gender, is always looked at as the other. Okay, so that you find in when you look at the ontology of the individual, and this is another important aspect which is to be taken into consideration. So in this way, basically, I can go on talking about each one of the branches of philosophy and try to explain you that there is a kind of genderedness in each one of the components of philosophical enterprise that we look at. But let me stop here with metaphysics, epistemology, and ontology. I can go to logic as well as to ethics as well, but I don't want to do that. But if you look at the practical world, even that you find many difficulties, and practical world is always filled with biasness and disparity that is clearly visible and available to us. So, but I have an interesting point that I would like to make here, with which I would stop. All of us know what are opposites, right? We do talk about opposites, and because we know very well, very clear about the opposites, we tend to create a kind of binary epistemology. All of us have this binary epistemology in our minds. When we look at things, we can only look at them in terms of opposites. When we look at the objects, we tend to look at the world of objects in terms of opposites. And this is the basic construction of the mind with which we are grown and with which we look at. For example, if I say, what is the opposite of fire, probably you would say water. And if I say, what is the opposite of male, you would say female. And if I say, what is the opposite of something, immediately you come up with what is the opposite of that. But this is a very dangerous kind of phenomena. And it is not completely true. Whatever we think to be opposites are not actually opposites. And they are not presented as opposites, at least in Indian tradition. This is what I would like to assert here before I stop. What I mean by that is, for example, if you look at the first example that I gave, like fire and air, you know, if you say fire and water are opposites, in fact, in Indian tradition, there are five elements that we have, and these elements are only complementary. All of them have to come together to produce something new. Each one of them is so important for the life of the human life in the world that unless they come together, nothing new comes into existence. So there is always a holistic and harmonious harmony that is integrated and harmonious kind of a life that is asserted in Indian tradition with regard to the things that we see to be opposites, which is a dangerous one. The second example that I give you is immediately we tend to tell our, see, unfortunately, even in this, you go to this English medium schools as well, we tend to unfortunately teach our younger kids that male and female are opposites, or boy and girl are opposites, which is a very dangerous phenomena. We are not supposed to teach them that way. In fact, what we are supposed to tell them is both of them are complementary. If you go on for generations teaching them that they are opposites, what kind of world do you expect? See, the kind of rupture and violence that you see in the world is not because of anything else, okay? It is because of the brought up, and it is because of the education. It is because of the epistemological framework, binary epistemological framework, with which we are fixing our kids. A tender mind of, say, fifth class or fourth class, you are teaching them that these are opposites. And then what? How do you expect them to grow up to be sympathetic to the other and understand that the other requires me and I require the other? There is an interdependency that is existent, and unless both come together, there is no life at all. How do you expect them to know? So this binary epistemology is a dangerous kind of epistemology which we are nurturing, unfortunately, and which is to be corrected. Okay. So when you go home, when you meet your students, please explain them saying that these are not opposites. In fact, they are complementary. Unless they come together in a harmonious way, nothing new comes into existence. Okay. And when I say this, what I mean to say is, I often repeat this, our epistemology determines our metaphysics, and our metaphysics influences our ethics, our action, human action. And this is to be completely kept in our mind when we teach our students, because most of us are teachers and students. So what is required here is a correction in our epistemology. When we teach, we have to be very careful regarding such kind of conceptions, which may contribute in future for any kind of violence or any kind of opposite kind of conception, which would result in rupture. So this is what I would like to say here, and I'm so happy. I appreciate Vasantha College for this wonderful opportunity that is given to me, and also coming forward for this collaboration. And I sincerely believe that such kind of collaboration should increase. In fact, in the recent past, I think 1 month back, our Vice Chancellor, Delhi University Vice Chancellor, held a meeting and argued that he started a new scheme in which he is asking the various departments in the university to mentor departments of philosophy at various colleges and universities all over the country. And similarly, he was requesting the colleges as well to mentor the colleges which are situated at remote places. And that is how they thought that the expertise of the faculty and students can be exchanged. Okay. So in the similar lines, I'm so happy that Vasantha College has come forward for this collaboration, and we really look forward to many such kind of collaborations in terms of not just in terms of academic events, even in terms of research projects, etc. as well. And I wish this event a grand success. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an elaborative and insightful speech you have given. And yes, you know, you have covered almost like all the aspects of this workshop, and also something which has not been covered entirely in the concept note. So the way you have elaborated that we should not only be concerned about the introduction or participation of women, but also the feminine aspect of it. So because these are two different things. So that is very important. I'm receiving so many requests from the participants that this session should also include Hindi language. So main koshish karti hu ki main Hindi mein bhi bolne ki koshish karu yahan pe, kyunki hum ek feminist philosophy ki baat kar rahe hain jahan pe exclusion ke virodh mein hum baat karna chahte hain. To kisi bhi tarike ka exclusion jo hai wo hum yahan pe nahi lana chahenge, chahe wo bhasha ki exclusion ho ya fir ling par aadharit exclusion ho. To जो अभी प्रोफेसर बाला गणपति ने कहा, मैं उस पर बस यही दो लाइन कहना चाहूंगी कि जिन भी चीजों को हमने बाइनरीज में समझा है, यानी दो दो विभिन्न विरोधी पक्षों के रूप में समझा है, उसको हमें एक पूरक के रूप में समझना है. और अगर हम सिर्फ इतना ही कर पाए तो वो एक बहुत बड़ा कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन होगा हमारी तरफ से इस सोसाइटी के लिए और इस एकेडमिक्स के लिए. और दूसरी बात जो है वो ये इम्पोर्टेंट है कि अगर फिलोसॉफिकल लेवल पर अगर हम अपने माइंडसेट को चेंज कर पाए, हम थ्योरीज को चेंज कर पाए, हम कॉन्सेप्चुअल एनालिसिस को चेंज कर पाए, क्रिटिकल थिंकिंग को चेंज कर पाए, तो वो चीज हमारे रोजमर्रा की जिंदगी में भी देखने को मिलेगी. और इस तरीके से उसमें सोसाइटी में रेगुलरली जो है वो चेंज लाया जा सकता है. तो इस वर्कशॉप का ऑब्जेक्टिव यही है कि हम डिस्कस करें फिलोसॉफिकल अप्रोच से भी और डिफरेंट अदर अप्रोच से भी. और ऐसे में हम कोशिश करें कि लोग जिस भी तरीके के बायसनेस से भरे हुए हैं, या वो समझ नहीं पा रहे हैं कि लिंग पर आधारित भेद जो है वो सिर्फ एक डिफरेंस है, वो कोई हायरार्किकल अरेंजमेंट का रीजन नहीं बनना चाहिए, क्योंकि हम एक दूसरे के पूरक हैं और सभी जेंडर्स पूरक हैं इस पूरे सोसाइटी को बनाने के। तो थैंक यू सो मच सर, आपने इतने अच्छे तरीके से सारे पक्षों को रखने की कोशिश की, क्योंकि मैं चाहूंगी कि यहाँ पे जितने भी स्पीकर्स हैं अगर वो बाइलिंगुअल हो सकते हैं तो बाइलिंगुअल होने की कोशिश करें, सो दैट कि किसी के भी साथ यहाँ पर कोई इनजस्टिस ना हो, चाहे वो भाषा से रिलेटेड ही क्यों ना हो। तो अब मैं अर्चना मैम से रिक्वेस्ट करना चाहूंगी कि वो आगे के सेशन को चेयर करें। थैंक यू मैम।
थैंक यू रितु, आपने बिल्कुल सही कहा। यहाँ जो हमारा टॉपिक है उसमें लैंग्वेज को क्यों लाया जा रहा है, यहाँ तो हमें ये देखना है कि हमारे बीच ये अंतर क्यों आ रहा है। क्योंकि अगर फिलोसोफर विमेन फिलोसोफर कितना कंट्रीब्यूट की और क्यों नहीं विमेन फिलोसोफर को आगे बढ़ने दिया गया, क्यों नहीं उनको देखा गया। और हर जगह जो है हम बहुत बाद में ट्रेडिशनल व्यू में अपाला घोसा गार्गी का नाम लेते हैं, आज हम अपाला घोसा गार्गी क्यों नहीं जो है अपने फिलोसफी फील्ड में जो है कंट्रीब्यूट कर पा रहे हैं। तो कहीं ना कहीं हमारा माइंडसेट है, कहीं ना कहीं हम जो है कॉन्सेप्चुअली उस चीज को मिसगाइड कर रहे हैं। तो इस वर्कशॉप का पर्पज है हमें इन पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू को देखना कि ऐसी क्या पोजीशन आई, ऐसी क्या कंडीशन आई कि हम विमेन को पीछे करते हैं और जो है एक तरह से ये हमारे बीच ये जगह खाली होता गया। आज मुझे बड़ा अफसोस होता है कि बहुत कम विमेन फिलोसोफर जो है कंट्रीब्यूट कर रही है। ठीक है, हम टीचर हैं, हम अपनी बात को रख सकते हैं, लेकिन अगर कहीं रिकॉग्नाइज करने की बात आती है तो बहुत कम किया जाता है। आज साउथ में ललित को कितने लोग जानते हैं, किसने उनको, जहां हम सेविज्म देख रहे हैं, जहां हम उनकी फिलोसफी वेदांत देख रहे हैं, कितने लोग ललित को आज जानते हैं। अगर हाँ कोई कॉन्फ्रेंस होता है, कोई वेबिनार की हम टॉपिक बनाते हैं तो हम एंशियंट पीरियड में जाके उनको ढूंढते हैं, लेकिन आज हमारे बीच तमाम महिलाएं जो गार्गी हैं, अपाला हैं, घोसा हैं, हम उन्हें क्यों नहीं पहचान रहे हैं। तो हमारा पर्पज है ये माइंडसेट करना। और मैं बाला सर की उस बात से भी सहमत हूँ कि बाला सर जब ये कह रहे हैं कि बीइंग एंड ये जो बिकमिंग वाला ये कंडीशन जो हमें बना रहे हैं, जो अपने एक तरह से हमें कहें कि जो हमारे अंदर एक इसको अगर हम अपनी भाषा में कहें तो कहीं ना कहीं लगता है कि महिलाओं में वो पावर है, वो कैपेसिटी है कि वो बहुत आगे बढ़ सकती है। हाँ हाँ, प्रणाम सर। और उसके बाद अगर हम उस कॉन्सेप्ट को चाहे वेस्टर्न में देखें चाहे इंडियन में देखें, दोनों जगह महिलाओं ने कंट्रीब्यूट किया है, पर अफसोस कि हम उन्हें आगे जो है नहीं देख पाते हैं या उस तरह के कॉन्सेप्ट को हम उनको आगे नहीं बढ़ा पाते हैं। तो यहाँ जो आप लोग बाइलिंगुअल बोल रहे हो, जो लैंग्वेज पे अभी मैं काफी कमेंट्स देख रही हूँ, प्लीज हमारा पर्पज ये नहीं है। और रही बात लैंग्वेज, कोई बैरियर नहीं है कि हम जो है उस पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से देखें, तो एक हेल्दी एटमॉस्फेयर लेते हुए और हम उस कंट्रीब्यूशन को देखें। आपको जब मैं कंट्रीब्यूशन हम लोग दिखाएंगे, हमारे सारे स्पीकर्स दिखाएंगे, तो आपको लगेगा कि रियली महिलाओं का बहुत बड़ा कंट्रीब्यूशन है। और सिर्फ ये क्रिएशन भी विदाउट विमेन पॉसिबल नहीं है, तो ये फिलोसफी भी विदाउट विमेन पॉसिबल नहीं है। पर कितना है कि हमें अपने एग्जिस्टेंस को जो ऑलरेडी हमें मिला है हमें उसको देखना है, बनाना है, पहचानना है। और आगे मैं अपनी इसी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू पे हमारी चंद्रकला मैम को पहले मैं इंट्रोड्यूस करना चाहती हूँ कि प्रोफेसर चंद्रकला पाड़िया इज वन ऑफ द वेल नोन फेमिनिस्ट स्कॉलर नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल लेवल। सी हैज सेवरल मेजर पब्लिकेशन ऑन विमेन स्टडीज, फेमिनिस्ट थियरीज एंड विमेन इन इंडिया इंटेलेक्चुअल ट्रेडिशन। सी इज प्रोफेसर एंड फॉर्मर हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस BHU वाराणसी। सी हैज ब्रिलियंटली वर्क एज द फॉर्मर वाइस चांसलर ऑफ MGS यूनिवर्सिटी बीकानेर राजस्थान। सी हैज प्लेड अ सिग्निफिकेंट रोल एज फॉर्मर डायरेक्टर एट सेंटर फॉर विमेन स्टडीज BHU विद सीरीज ऑफ पब्लिकेशन ऑफ एडिटोरियल वर्क्स ऑन विमेन स्टडीज। She has also delivered her dedicated service as former Dean Faculty of Social Science BHU. She has also been the former chairperson of Indian Institute of Advanced Studies Shimla. She has also rendered her service As a former president of the Society of the Indian Institute of Advanced Society, Shimla, she is also a member of Central Advisory Board of Education, MHRD, New Delhi, and also working as a member of Indian National Commission for Cooperation with UNESCO, MHRD, New Delhi. I welcome ma'am on behalf of Department of Philosophy and Champion Committee, the Department of Philosophy, Delhi University. I would like to invite Professor Padia ma'am for the keynote address. Padia ma'am ka jab bhi lecture hota hai, marvelous. Aur hum log BHU mein is cheez ko mehsoos kiya hai. Aur Padia ma'am ke saath hum log ne us lecture ko enjoy kiya hai. To ab main Padia ma'am se request kar rahi hoon ki Padia ma'am apna keynote address dein. Padia ma'am.
Thank you Archana ji for your very kind words. Am I audible? मेरी आवाज सुनाई पड़ रही है
जी मैम यू आर ऑडिबल
ओके ओके डॉक्टर अलका सिंह द एनलाइटेंड प्रिंसिपल ऑफ वसंता कॉलेज श्री श्रीपति दुबे जी लर्नेड मैनेजर ऑफ द कॉलेज प्रोफेसर डी बाला गणपति जी अ वेरी वेल नोन स्कॉलर एंड प्रेजेंटली द हेड पॉलिटिकल द हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिलोसफी यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली टू डायनेमिक कन्वीनर्स ऑफ दिस सेमिनार Dr. Ritu Jaiswal, Department of Philosophy, Delhi University, and Dr. Archana Tripathi, Department of Philosophy, Vasanta College, all distinguished members of Vasanta College family, participants from other colleges and universities. At the outset, let me thank Vasanta College and its team for inviting me to deliver the lecture on such an important topic. In fact, I must say I have been benefited by the deliberations made earlier. I have no words how beautifully the head of the Department of Philosophy, Delhi University, he has brought to our notice some very pertinent questions and the methodology with which we should look at the position of women in philosophy. So, and our Dubey ji, your manager Dubey ji, the principal, both the conveners, they have made my task easier. In fact, this topic, I will have to deal in two parts. First, position of women in Western philosophy, and second, position of women in Indian philosophy. You know, women's position in Western and Indian philosophy are different. Whereas in the Western, and when I'm using the word philosophy, I'm only speaking at the theoretical level. There is a great difference between theory and practice. I'm not talking of practice, I'm only talking of theory. Whereas in the Western philosophy, women occupy a secondary status. In Indian philosophy, women occupy a very significant place, at times superior to men. But what I say about position of women in Indian philosophy, as I just said you, only applies in theory, not in practice. Over a period of time, the status of women declined in Indian society. Now let me begin with position of women in Western philosophy. In the traditional Western philosophy, women have been devalued. They have trivialized women's moral concerns. All major concepts and theories of traditional philosophy reveal a distinctively masculine way of approaching the world. The philosophers have mostly used value hierarchical thinking and normative dualism, for they give greater value to what is seen as higher. For example, men, culture, minds or reasons, and lesser value to what is seen as lower, for example, women, nature, bodies or emotion. Normative dualism is exhibited when they create binary distinctions, as was very well defined by your head of the department, between mind, body, reason, emotion, man, woman, and so on. This we call as the logic of domination, an attempt to justify the subordination of the lower by the higher. In all the three spheres of philosophy, methodology, epistemology, and ontology, male-centric biases have pervaded throughout. In the realm of methodology, you all must be knowing, Greek believed in rationalism, which posited logic as the final test of the truth. In the 17th and 18th century, empiricism treated sense perception to be the sole source of valid human knowledge. Hegelian dialectics believed in the supremacy of reason as thought proceeds by contradiction and the reconciliation of contradictions. Even Karl Marx believed in dialectical materialism, where knowledge and ideas are reflections of material conditions. Even Descartes, who claimed that this method would be suitable even for women, assumed that philosophic activities demand total concentration, free from all practical concerns. Thus, in Western philosophy, with few exceptions, philosophers have treated the private realm of the family as a realm mired in the concrete, particular, and subjective, and thus not worthy of sustained philosophical reflections. Friends, you will be surprised to see that how women have been denigrated by Plato, Aristotle, Rousseau, Hegel, and all these thinkers. But I can quote from them how, in what way they have treated women. In the realm of epistemology, the question, how do you know, is always answered in the Western philosophy through reason. A high value is always placed on reason and rationality, and this reason is always defined in opposition to emotion. Women have always been associated with emotion and not with reason. Aristotle claims that women do not have rationality. If they have it, it is in a very inferior way. In the Middle Ages, Saint Augustine did not extend the privilege of male rationality to women. Now, in the era of modern age, one discovers the same kind of thought present in Descartes, who makes a desperate attempt to escape from the body, sexuality, and the wiles of the unconscious. For Spinoza, a strong man is that who is a man of reason. It becomes evident here that the ideal for Spinoza is masculine one. Woman is always equated with a being who is under the sway of passions, untransformed by reason. Thus, in Western philosophy, not only has reason been contrasted with emotion, but has also been associated with the mental, the cultural, the universal, the public, and the male. Whereas emotion has been associated with the irrational, the physical, the natural, the particular, the private, and of course, the female. In the realm of metaphysics oblique ontology, traditional metaphysicians have often sought to provide answers to broad questions, such as, what are the fundamental categories and structures of reality? What is the nature of things? And what is being as such, only on the basis of their own experiences? It is only the dominant group of men who is in a position to define reality for themselves and for their subordinates. Several dichotomies, self-other, spirit-matter, mind-body, and active-passive are the creation of this ontology, which reflect the fundamental opposition of male-female, dominant-subordinate, and valued-devalued beings. I must tell you, Indian philosophy never talks in terms of such binaries. Thus, in the Western philosophy, women have had the world mediated for them by men. Men have told women what the nature of thing is. Women have been erased by the patriarchal concept of reality. Reality is what is seen to be, and what is not seen is not real. Women who are not seen or are not visible are thereby not real. They do not exist. And this is the reason I would just like to quote some of the things. You just see Plato. Plato in his Laws declares that woman is by nature inclined to be secretive and crafty because of her weakness. And her, I quote, and her natural potential for virtue is inferior to a man's, and so she is potentially a greater danger, perhaps even twice as great, unquote. You see how what Aristotle says. Aristotle says she only provides matter to the process of reproduction. And the imprint of human personality on this matter, please listen to it carefully, and the imprint of human personality on this matter is provided by the father. Man is the active agent, that is why he may be regarded as superior to woman. Again, to quote Aristotle, virtues and actions are nobler when they proceed from those who are naturally worthier. For instance, from a man rather than from a woman, unquote. And I can go on quoting from Hegel, Rousseau, and others, how they have denigrated women in the Western philosophy. This is not the case in Indian philosophy. Friends, I would like to tell you that since the beginning, I have been taught something which were very different from what I now believe. Because we have had the habit of reading from the secondary sources. And when you read from the secondary sources, you are misled. And when you go into the original sources, then only you can know what is the real thing. In Indian philosophy, women have been given equal status at ontological level in matters of character, restraint, social harmony, and public welfare. Women have been given a higher position than that of men. The equal status granted to women at the ontological level can be seen in the oldest philosophical text of India, that is Rig Veda. This Ved believes in the single source of entire creation. The Nasadiya Sukta of Rig Veda claims that there was one will manifesting itself in many forms, including the male and the female. That's a very famous quote, Nasda Sinno Sada Siddhanim Nasi Drajo No Yomo Paroyat Kima Varivaha Kuhkasya Sharma Nabha Kima Sid Gahanam Gambhira. This is in the Rig Veda 10th Mandal 129 verse. The same view has been expressed in Kathopanishad, and Manusmriti also subscribes to the same viewpoint. Contrary to Western philosophy, women has been given more importance than men, be it in the field of knowledge or power or wealth. In the realm of knowledge, women were treated blessed with more insight, more human values, and knowledge. Manu, who has been critiqued like anything, abused like anything. If he would have had been alive, I personally feel he would have had a heart attack because people totally misunderstood him. Manu has categorically claimed one acharya surpasses 10 ordinary teachers. One father surpasses 100 acharyas. And above all, one mother surpasses 1,000 father. Just imagine, just remember this quote. It is in the Manusmriti, chapter 2, verse 145. This is all the more clear when we discover the same terminologies and adjectives which have been used both for men and women. To cite a few examples, if Atharved, because I cannot go like saying Mandal, this, so I will just say like this, if Atharved 8/5/4 regards man as Ojaswan, then Yajurved 10/3 regards women as Ojaswati. If Atharved regards man as Sahastravira, the same Atharved calls women as Sahastravirya. If Rigved titles man as Sahiyam, the Atharved titles woman as Sahiyasi. If Rigved calls man as Samrat, then the same Rigved calls woman as Samragi. Similarly, if Rigved calls man as Manishi, the same Rigved calls women as Manisha. All footnotes are with me, references are with me. If man is called in Atharveda as Sabhasad, the same Atharveda calls woman as Sabhasada. Just imagine what kind of adjectives are there, and they have been used both for men and women. In the realm of power, women were treated not only as powerful, but as the source of all power. Even devatas were regarded as powerless without women. What is most striking is the fact that even the most powerful Lord Shiva was said to be Shav without Shakti. You just see what has been said in Saundarya Lahari. I would like to quote that. Shiva Shaktaya Yukto Yadi Bhavati Shaktah Prabhuvirtum Nache Devam Devo Nakhalu Kushlah Spanditum Api. Shiva becomes capable of creating the universe only when united with Shakti. But otherwise, he is incapable of even a stir. How then could one who has not acquired merit in this and a previous birth's worship be, or at least praise thee? The reason that Argala Strotam of Durga Saptashati, which we always read, goes to the extent of saying that which you will never find in the realm of women, in the realm of Western philosophy. Because I have been teaching Western philosophy, women in Western philosophy, and have almost gone through all the thinkers through the original sources, and also the Indian philosophy and such a thing. During Durga Saptasati, Argala Strotam says, wives can elevate men from the mundane world. When Ramakrishna Paramahans ke paas maa Sharda gayi aur unke bistre par ja karke baithi, to Ramakrishna Paramahans ne pucha ki kya tum mujhe sansar mein khichne laayi ho? Us maa Sharda ne, jo hamare shabdon mein nirakshar thi wo, lekin kitna tez tha, us maa Sharda ne kaha, nahi, मैं तुम्हें संसार में खींचने नहीं लाई हूँ, मैं तुम्हें संसार सागर से उतारने लाई हूँ, संसार सागर से उस पार ले जाना चाहती हूँ। तो पत्नी मनोरमाम देही मनोवृत्तानुसारिणीं तारिणीं दुर्ग संसार सागरस्य कुलो भावम। हाउ सरप्राइजिंग इट इज दैट व्हेन इन द वेस्टर्न फिलोसफी अरिस्टॉटल ट्रीटेड मैन एज मोर वर्चुअस एंड मोर डिवाइन इन नेचर, the Indian philosopher did just the opposite. He finds women as more virtuous and more divine in nature. All these differences arise because Indian philosophy believes that the soul is neither male nor female. Therefore, there was no ground for preferring man to woman. For genius abides in the soul, not in the bodily frame. Rajshekhar, in his Kavya Mimamsa, clearly says, you all know that, he says, Sanskaro hi atmani sam vaitin sklenam parusham va vibhagam apachate. One can discover several examples in Indian philosophy where women have been treated not only as equals, but superior to men in many ways. In Rig Veda, it has been said, in Mandal 5th, many a woman is more steadfast and better than the man who turns away from God and does not offer prayers. Rig Veda also claims that she who discerns the weak and worn, the man who thirsts and is in want, she sets her mind upon the gods. The problem with us is that we have never we never treat them, and that is the reason. And the only Smriti, there is not only one Smriti, there are such radical Smritis like Parashar Smriti and others, but we only confine to Manusmriti, and Manusmriti also we do not see in what context the particular thing has been said. For example, you will find several times we keep on quoting that Sriyam Swatantram Na Arhati. You know all that. Pata Rakshati Kaumare Bharta Rakshati Yavane. Now here the word Swatantrata is not the same Swatantrata which we today in the liberal philosophy use. What is the concept of the individual in the liberal philosophy? That man is a self-defining subjectivity. If you read Manusmriti carefully, Manu has used the word Swatantrata in the sense of Suraksha. But what we do, we try to impose our own contemporary meanings and terminologies on the authors who have used those terminologies in altogether a different sense. The Vashishtha Dharma Sutra heightens the emphasis even more by observing that woman is 100 times superior to man in instructing and elevating a child. Parashar Smriti declares that wife is the refuge of her husband in times of trouble, and that if only for this reason, she should not be made the victim of exploitation and oppression by him. As the snake charmer can pull out a snake from its hole, similarly, a true pious woman can redeem her husband from moral turpitude. Apastamba has a different yet fairly acceptable way of arguing for the superiority of women. He argues that insofar as a mother serves her son in numberless ways and quite selflessly, he should not desert her, even if for some reason she has been tempted to take to devious ways. It can be, to my mind, unequivocally claimed that position of women in Indian philosophy is very different from that of Western philosophy. I am talking of ancient times, Greek times, and of Middle Ages. I am not talking of the contemporary period. Indian philosophy does not believe, this is a very important point, in the dominant masculinist view of rationality. It rejects the sharp disjunction between reason and feeling, the equation of rationality with impersonality, of justice with abstract impartiality, and of equality with uniformity. Further, Indian philosophy does not believe in normative dualism. Different roles have been assigned to different persons in accordance with their individual natures and aptitudes. Moreover, it derives its basic premises from that cultural tradition which advocates an integrated working of the body, mind, and spirit, without which attainment of the ultimate end of life is not possible. Full stop. To conclude on the basis of the verses which I have many mentioned in India's ancient philosophical text, one can claim that Indian philosophy believes in the concept of Ardha Narishwar and Sahadharmini. This point has been very well explained by the distinguished manager of your college, Dubeji, and also by the head of the Department of Philosophy. And that is why whenever we talk about any of the texts, you know, two questions were raised by the Balaganeshan ji, and very aptly he has raised them, that we should also look at not only how many philosophers have been there. We all know that in India, Maitreya, Gargi, and so many philosophers were there. At least 26 names we know. 26 names are very well known. And that is not only the criteria for knowing her position. But we should also see whether the notion of femininity has been given a place in the philosophy or not. And here comes the great, great role of Indian philosophy. In Indian philosophy, femininity has been given too much of importance. Women are being treated greater because of their nurturing abilities, because of their mothering abilities, because of their reproductive abilities. And here, reason and emotion have never been treated as contradictory to each other. You just imagine, you just take the contemporary. In the Western philosophy, these things came. There are Mary Estelle and so many others, but mainly with Mary Wollstonecraft, who wrote Vindications of the Rights of Women in the 18th century. And after that, John Stuart Mill. And after that, you will find so many other thinkers came up. Marxist thinker, socialist thinker, postmodern thinker. I have worked on French feminist thinkers. All of them came. And you will be surprised to see that today, in the present contemporary discourse, Carol Pateman, whether it is Carol Pateman, whether it is Sela Ben-Habib of Harvard University, whether Carol Pateman is from Australia, and whether it is Anjay Dua from Mexico, whether it is Trinity Minh Ha from Vietnam, all these thinkers from different parts of the world, what they have tried to say, that we must believe that man and woman, they are equal, but they are different. Unless and until we recognize the difference, we will never be able to do justice with women. Carol Macmillan, she says that all notions are, she has said one sentence which is very, very important. She says, all gender equal laws are gender blind laws. Unless and until we take cognizance of the fact that there are different needs of men and women, no equality, no freedom is possible for women. But all these things have come only, you will find, after the Second World War. After Simone de Beauvoir came forward, how a woman and that all those differences between gender and all those things have come into existence. What I would like to say, that in the West, this notion of women's freedom, women's dignity has come only after the Second World War mainly, and that also starting from 18th century. But if you look at the philosophical text of India, you will find it is so old. In the Rig Veda, 2000 years back, if you look at the Rig Veda, same source of creation. If you look at the Atharva Veda, you will find that the same source of creation, they have been treated as equals. And rather, there are so many misgivings about the position of women in Indian philosophy because we do not read the original sources. You know, there are many things Manusmriti remained for 13, only it came into light in the 13th century when Medhatithi codified it. Before that, it was there only as an oral tradition. And because it was as an oral tradition, that is why so many misgivings have been there. how can Manu, who says yat naryastu pujyante ramante tatva devata, how can he say such other things which are being off quoted from here and there? There have been interpolations like Birbal and Akbar's katha. You know, everything which has been said in a manner, you will find it has been said by Birbal and it has been said by Akbar. It should not be like that. Academics is a very serious thing. Now we have to realize that women has to be treated as a category of analysis. If we do not incorporate women as a category of analysis, we are going to do lot of injustice to half of the population of the world. And still we have to go far, far in order to attain that kind of unity. But we will have to look back to our original representative texts. All the smritis and other things, you know, they have come later on. But our original texts are Vedas and Upanishads. No one talks about Upanishads Sakhi Bhav, Sakha Bhav. Because many of our students, you know, we have not provided them with the literature. And so many of them do not know it. But our younger generation is now very curious to know about India's intellectual tradition. How radical they have been. Can you believe, can you imagine that, you know, that the right to divorce, which has been given by Kautilya and in Parashar Smriti, has not yet been given by our constitution. The kind of importance women have been given. You just read that. You just find if a man has gone abroad and he does not, you know, has done any arrangement for your economic benefit, or then economic survival, then you can leave that husband. And not only you can leave that husband, you can remarry. So there are Parashar Smriti, but we never teach Parashar Smriti. We never teach Kautilya's Arthashastra in the context of woman. And that is why India's intellectual tradition has been mutilated, has been deformed, has been distorted by the, not only by the Western thinkers, I'm sorry to say, by the Indian scholars also. Now there has come a time when we should read these original texts and we should critique it. I'm not saying that we should not criticize it. Wherever, you know, one of the great scholars from Varanasi always used to say, tradition is like a tree. When it grows, when a plant grows, you know, the grass also, ghas bhi ugne lagti hai. तो हम क्या करते हैं, प्लांट को तो नहीं निकाल सकते हैं, हम घास में जो घास होती है उसको हम वीड आउट करते हैं ताकि कि प्लांट पूरी तरह से ग्रो कर सके। तो इसी प्रकार से जब भी कोई स्वस्थ परंपरा जन्म लेती है तो उसमें समय के कारण हमारी हमारी जो दुर्भावनाएं हैं, हमारी जो नीचताएं हैं, उनके कारण उसमें बहुत सारी घास उगाती है। आवश्यकता इस बात की है कि हम घास को निकालें, इस बात की नहीं है कि हमारा जो मूल प्लांट है, जो सस्टेनेबल है, जिसने सस्टेन किया है, जिसने हमें बहुत सारी प्रॉब्लम से बचाया है, उस प्लांट को ही हम उखाड़ के फेंक दें। बच्चे को जब हम टब में नहाते हैं, पानी गंदा हो जाता है, तो हम पानी को फेंक देते हैं कि बच्चे को टब में से उठा के फेंक देते हैं। वही हम कर रहे हैं आज अपने देश में। तो इसलिए देयर इज अ नीड, फिलोसफी इज द फाउंडेशन ऑफ एवरी साइंस. And that is why whether you do PhD in mathematics or political science, you will get the degree doctor of philosophy. Because it is, you know, you go to the root of the problem. And the root of the problem is that as an academician, we must read the original text. And when you read the original text, you will find that how we have distorted and misrepresented our own text, which Edward Said calls as Orient. So with these words, I once again thank you. I think if I have taken more time, please excuse me. I thank Archana ji, I thank Ritu Jaiswal ji, Alka ji, for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts. And then whatever the questions are there, I will welcome those questions. Thank you very much.
थैंक यू मैम, आपने इतनी बढ़िया रोचक ढंग से अपनी बातों को प्रस्तुत की. आपने इंडियन और वेस्टर्न के सारे एस्पेक्ट को दिखाया कि जहाँ पे अंतर कहाँ हो रहा है, कहीं ना कहीं हमने उसकी गलत व्याख्या की है। उसके साथ आपने वेद उपनिषद, साथ में अथर्ववेद, ऋग्वेद, तमाम ऐसे कोटेशन को आपने हमारे सामने रखा जहाँ पे स्त्रियों को इम्पोर्टेंस दिया गया है, और कहीं उसे मनीषी कहा गया है तो कहीं उसे मनीषा कहा गया है, तो कहीं जो है उसे विदुषी कहा गया है, तो कहीं उसे सभासद भी कहा गया है। यानी पुरुषों से ज्यादा शक्तिशाली उस समय की स्त्रियां थी। और आपका ये कहना कि जब भी कोई भी चेंजेज आते हैं या जब कंटेम्प्रेरी हमारी फिलोसफी की शुरुआत होती है, उसके पहले हम देखें, अगर बहुत ट्रेडिशनल वे में जाके देखें तो मैन और वुमेन में बहुत ज्यादा अंतर नहीं था, क्योंकि आपने ये भी कहा कि विदाउट पावर जो है शिव एक जस्ट लाइक अ डेड बॉडी, यानी शिव का भी एग्जिस्टेंस तभी है जब शिवा उसके साथ है। ये क्रिएशन भी विदाउट वुमेन पॉसिबल नहीं है। तो अगर हम ट्रेडिशनल वे में जाके देखें, महिलाओं की स्थिति अच्छी थी, और जितने भी हमारे उसमें जो महिला दार्शनिक थे, चाहे पाला हो, गोसा हो, गार्गी हो, मैत्रेयी हो, सबका कंट्रीब्यूशन दिखाई देता है। और मनुस्मृति से कहीं ना कहीं ये सारी परंपराओं का जन्म होता है, और थोड़े से जो अंतर हमारे बीच उत्पन्न होते हैं वो दिखता है। और जब भी कोई ऐसी परंपरा जन्म लेती है तो तमाम विविधताएं जन्म लेती हैं, और शायद यही कारण है कि आज हम विमेन पोजीशन की बात कर रहे हैं फिलोसफी में, यानी अपने ही अस्तित्व को ढूंढ रहे हैं। तो मैम आपकी बहुत बढ़िया प्रेजेंटेशन, वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव एंड रेलेवेंट एक्सप्लेनेशन, थैंक यू सो मच। अब मैं राजेश जी को आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट डॉक्टर राजेश चौरसिया टू प्रेजेंट द फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स। डॉक्टर राजेश चौरसिया जी, माइक, हेलो
मेरी आवाज आ रही है ना?
बिल्कुल आ रही है, बिल्कुल आ रही है।
दरअसल
म्यूट कर दो मेरा।
ये वॉल ऑफ थिंग्स जो मैं देने जा रहा हूँ, ये हमारे डिपार्टमेंट की जो हेड हैं डॉक्टर रमा पांडे जी को देना था, लेकिन चूंकि वो बहुत अस्वस्थ हैं इसलिए उनकी जगह मैं ये काम करने जा रहा हूं। तो मैं धन्यवाद देता हूं बहुत ये सबसे पहले हमारी प्राचार्य जी अलका जी, जिन्होंने बहुत अच्छी तरीके से आज इस विषय को उठाया कि कहीं ना कहीं कुछ ना कुछ तो ऐसा है। अब उसी की छानबीन के लिए हम लोग ये वर्कशॉप कर रहे हैं कि ऐसा क्या है कि जो पोजीशन ऑफ विभिन्न फिलोसफर्स है, और जैसे ऋतु जी ने बार बार कहा कि ये सिर्फ फिलोसफी की बात नहीं है, हम किसी भी एकेडमी में देखें, चाहे हम साइंस में देखें, चाहे किसी भी विषय में देखें, कहीं ना कहीं हमें ऐसा लगता है कि जो विभिन्न पार्टिसिपेशन है वह कमजोर है उतना जितना होना चाहिए, जिस तरह से वो जो विमेन है वो हमारे मतलब आधी जनसंख्या है इस दुनिया की, उतना हमें देखने को नहीं मिल रहा है। तो मैं अलका जी का बहुत बहुत आभार करती हूँ, उन्होंने बहुत अच्छे से उठाया। उसके बाद हमारे मैनेजर श्रीपति दुबे जी, एस एन दुबे जी, उन्होंने भी बताया कि कुछ न कुछ ऐसी गड़बड़ियां हैं जिसके कारण हम लोग विमेन्स का उतना रिप्रेजेंटेशन नहीं देख पा रहे हैं जितना कि हमको देखना चाहिए। और मैं बहुत बहुत आभार मान रहा हूँ हमारे प्रोफेसर बाला गणपति जी का, उन्होंने बहुत ही अच्छी तरीके से दिखाया इस चीज़ को कि अगर हम लोग, हमारा इशू सिर्फ ये नहीं है कि पहले कितने विमेन्स फिलोसफर्स हुए हैं और उनकी गिनती करना भर नहीं है, हमको ये भी देखना पड़ेगा कि वास्तव में जो फिलोसफी है, जो मेटाफिजिक्स है, जो हमारा ज्ञान मीमांसा है, उसमें फेमाइन व्यू है कि नहीं। इससे मतलब हम लोग पुरुष के ही दृष्टिकोण से चीजों को देख रहे हैं एपिस्टेमोलॉजी में और सत्ता मीमांसा में और तत्व मीमांसा में, उसमें कहीं ना कहीं ये बात मुझे बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लगी। मैं चाहूंगा कि आगे तो उनका खुद पूरा पूरा एक लेक्चर है, तो इस बात को कहीं ना कहीं वो दिखाएं कि कैसे क्या और आगे हो सकता है कि सिर्फ मतलब एक ये है कि रिप्रेजेंटेशन जो एक फेमाइन रिप्रेजेंटेशन हो सकता है, जो उसका भी एक दृष्टिकोण हो सकता है, जैसे बार बार जैसे आप किसी भी किताब को पढ़ें, जैसे ये दो किताब मेरी बहुत फेवरेट हैं, एक तो सीमा दुबुआ की सेकंड सेक्स और महादेव वर्मा की श्रृंखला कड़ियां, दोनों जैसे अभी चंद्रकला पाड़िया मैम ने भी बताया कि इक्वलिटी एक उन्होंने स्टेटमेंट दिया था कि मैन एंड वोमेन आर इक्वल बट दे आर डिफरेंट, तो जो एक डिफरेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू आना चाहिए फिलोसफी में, एपिस्टेमोलॉजी में, वो हमको देखने को नहीं मिल रहा है, ऐसा मुझे लग रहा है कि बाला गणपति जी हमें बताने की कोशिश कर रहे थे, तो मैं उनको बहुत बहुत आभार करता हूँ। और इसके बाद हमारे अगली जो ऋतु जी ने, मैं हो सकता है क्रम भूल गया हूँ, मैंने लिख के भी रखा, मुझे लगा भी शायद प्रोग्राम और चलेगा, हो सकता है क्रम इधर उधर हो गया हो, तो ऋतु जी ने बहुत अच्छे ही तरीके से अपना ये जो इस वर्कशॉप का कॉन्सेप्ट रखा कि कॉन्सेप्ट क्या है वास्तव में। और मुझे एक बात ऋतु जी की बहुत अच्छी लगती है कि वो जो उनका जो फेमाइन का कॉन्सेप्ट है वो थोड़ी बड़ा लेके चलती है, जैसा कि अभी भाषा के लेके भी बाद में कमेंट दे रही थी कि हमारा तो पूरा का पूरा प्रयास ये है कि कोई 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 भी चीज मार्जिनलाइज नहीं होना चाहिए, मतलब किसी चीज को हाशिए पे नहीं जाना चाहिए, चाहे वो भाषा ही क्यों ना हो। और वो इस तरह से पहले भी उन्होंने एक बार इस विषय पे एक व्याख्यान दिया था, तो ये बात आज भी उन्होंने इस बात को रखने की कोशिश की है कि ये जो कॉन्सेप्ट, ये जो उनका जो उनका कॉन्सेप्ट है, और वास्तव में हम लोग इसी बात की खोज इस वर्कशॉप में भी कर रहे हैं कि किसी भी कहीं भी किसी भी चीज में किसी को हाशिए पे नहीं जाना चाहिए, चाहे वेमेन हो, चाहे वो दलित वर्ग हो, चाहे वो किसी भी प्रकार का कोई अन्याय नहीं होना चाहिए। तो मैं उनका ऋतु जी का बात का बहुत बहुत आभार मान रहा हूँ। इसके बाद जो चंद्रकला पाड़िया जी हैं, वो तो हम सबकी बहुत रिस्पेक्टेड हैं और हम सबको पता है कि वो विशेषज्ञ इस विषय की, तो जैसा उन्होंने अपने अपनी विशेषता के अनुरूप हम लोगों को बताया कि ये जो इंडियन जो जो पॉजिट जो हमारा विषय है विमेन पोजिशन इन फिलोसफी, उसमें उन्होंने ये दिखाने की कोशिश की कि दोनों में अलग अलग, वेस्टर्न फिलोसफी में बिल्कुल अलग पोजीशन है विमेन की और इंडियन फिलोसफी अलग है। और उन्होंने मुझे लगा थोड़ी सी चुटकी लेते हुए ये बात बताई है कि जो वेस्टर्न फिलोसफी में थियोरेटिकली जो पोजीशन है वो ठीक नहीं है विमेन की, लेकिन इंडियन फिलोसफी में थियोरेटिकली तो ठीक है, लेकिन प्रैक्टिकली हम जब देखते हैं तो वो हमको वो चीज हमको हमारे समाज में हमारी वो चीज हमको देखने को नहीं मिलती है। तो ये बात मुझे चंद्रकला पाड़िया जी की बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लगी और हम लोग सच में बहुत आभारी हैं उनका, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आभार व्यक्त कर रहे हैं कि उन्होंने अपना कीमती समय निकाला और इस वर्कशॉप को एक प्रकार की विशेष प्रकार की महत्ता को प्रदान किया यहाँ पर। और उसके बाद मैं और बाकी जितने भी लोग यहाँ पे इसमें लगे हुए हैं, चाहे हमारे वो टेक्निकल टीम हो, हमारी अर्चना जी हैं, ऋतु जी हैं, दोनों कोऑर्डिनेट इसको बहुत अच्छे से कोऑर्डिनेट कर रहे हैं। और ये चूंकि विमेन को ऊपर हो रहा है ये वाला, तो ये दोनों हमारे कोऑर्डिनेटर, देखिए पिछली बार एक शिकायत आ रही थी हमारे वर्कशॉप में कि कम रिप्रेजेंटेशन है विमेन का, लेकिन इस बार आप देखें कि कहीं ना कहीं सारे लेक्चर्स में हर जगह। और मैं जो हिंदी वाला ये जो मामला आ रहा है बार बार, कुछ लोग ये कह रहे हैं कि हिंदी में भी होना चाहिए, तो मैंने पहले ही रिक्वेस्ट किया था कि हमारा जो वर्कशॉप विषय है केवल इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज में नहीं है, लेकिन मैं पहले भी ये बात अपने कमेंट में लिख चुका हूँ कि हमें इस बात की रिस्पेक्ट करना चाहिए कि कोई भी किसी भी भाषा में अपनी बात को रख सकता है, इंग्लिश में भी रख सकता है और हिंदी में भी रख सकता है। और हमारे यहाँ बहुत सारे वक्ता ऐसे हैं जो हिंदी में भी आगे अपनी बात को रखेंगे, तो आपको जो भी इस बात से बहुत मतलब अपने आप को ठीक महसूस नहीं कर रहे हैं वो इस बात से निराश ना हो कि हमारा ये वर्कशॉप केवल इंग्लिश में ही होगा, ये हिंदी में भी होगा। तो इसके साथ ही हम सारे लोगों को जो और छूट भी गए हैं सारे लोग जो हमारी सारी कमेटी है उन सबको मैं बहुत बहुत आभार व्यक्त करता हूँ। और इसी के साथ ही मैं जीतू जी को, अर्चना जी को कहता हूँ कि वो आगे की बात बताएं हम लोगों को। थैंक यू वेरी मच, थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू।
इसके साथ इस वर्कशॉप में बहुत से ऐसे प्रोफेसर काशी विद्यापीठ और BHU से हैं, हमारे द्विवेदी सर हैं और इधर शिवानी जी हैं, काफ़ी सभी लोग हमारे इस इनॉग्रल सेशन में आए और उन्होंने इसको सुना और अपना आशीर्वाद दिया, इसके लिए मैं बहुत धन्यवाद आप सभी का। रितु,
जी मैम, हेलो मैम, हाँ मैं ये कहना चाहती हूँ मैम, पहले मैं ये बता दूं कि जिन भी लोगों को व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप ज्वाइन करने में प्रॉब्लम हो रही है, मैंने इस चैट बॉक्स में ऑलरेडी लिंक शेयर कर दिया है, तो वो दूसरा व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप ज्वाइन कर ले और उसी में ही इंफॉर्मेशन रेगुलरली सर्कुलेट की जाएगी। और इसके बाद से जो हमारा प्रोग्राम है अब वो 4 o'clock पे शुरू होगा, जो कि अब सेशंस के साथ शुरू होगा। सो आई होप कि आप लोगों को सारे लेक्चर्स और सारे सेशंस पसंद आए। और आज हम शुरू करेंगे 4 o'clock पे, जिसमें प्रोफेसर लक्ष्मी बांदला मुदी जो है डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ साइकोलॉजी से, उनका सेशन होगा, उनका लेक्चर होगा। सो इन शब्दों के साथ और साथ में यू नो मैं एक आई विल लाइक टू से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स अबाउट प्रोफेसर चंद्रकला पाड़िया मैम्स लेक्चर, दैट द वे शी हैज प्रेजेंटेड द डिफरेंस बिटवीन वेस्टर्न एंड इंडियन पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ इट, दैट हैज बीन वंडरफुली डन। एंड यस वी नीड टू गो थ्रू द मेन टेक्स्ट, बट मैम आई वुड लाइक टू डिसअग्री टू सम पॉइंट, यू नो, बिकॉज दिस इज अ फील्ड ऑफ फिलोसफी एंड वी हैव बीन you know trained in doing that we should always raise questions and we should always try to critically think about things. So it's like, you know, yes, you know, as Professor Bala has said that yes, we have so many names, you know, and so many women philosophers names, so many women thinkers names who are there and who have contributed well. And also the place of woman as a mother has been like revered, and she has been given so much of importance in society too at some extent. But we will have to see whether all the aspects of women has been respected or not, whether it has been included or not, and whether women's you know status on the textual level, at the textual level, and also at the practical level, whether they are matching with each other or not. So all these issues are quite important. Yes, we can see that in Western tradition there has always been this problem of looking at things from a binarous perspective, you know, where we have tried to create a distinction between rational and emotion and black and white and, you know, something like that. Whereas in Indian tradition, we have always tried to incorporate things into one single identity, and primarily in the Advaitic philosophy. So, but, you know, there are other traditions as well. So we'll have to see that how Nyayik philosophy is trying to create the to give importance to plurality, and Jain philosophy is also trying to give importance to plurality. So what is the significance of this plurality? Because until or unless we see and recognize the plurality and differences which exist at the social level, we will not be able to do justice with the identity of these people. So with these words, I would like to say that yes, you know, we have to work together, but simultaneously, yes, we will have to recognize the differences as well. Okay, thank you so much, ma'am, and thank you so much everyone for being here and for supporting us. And Rachna ma'am, over to you now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. And now, session is over. Thank you, sir. Bala Ganapati, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you, Archana ji and Ritu.
Thank you, Pariya ma'am. Wonderful. Thank you, sir. Okay, sir.